Hi, Meg here, and it might be no surprise to you at all that I am a big fan of all things acoustic guitars. In today's video, I thought it would be quite fun to delve a little bit into the history of acoustic guitars and where they came from, something I've always been quite fascinated about. Now stick with me on this one, it may not be the most exciting video title, but I learned so much researching this, and guitar lovers out there watching, I think you might too. Before the days of Marshall stacks, Stratocasters, and distortion pedals, musicians didn't have too much choice over what equipment was available to them. With the rise of blues, jazz, and big band in the early 20th century, there was definitely a need and requirement for guitarists to have a loud guitar that will carry over the band. Remember, there was no microphones used in music until around 1930, so before that, it really was essential that guitars were loud. This is really where the evolution of the acoustic guitar began. So let's dive a little bit into a history of acoustic guitars, where they originally started and what the first ones looked like. It's been noted that the first acoustic guitar that was not a classical was introduced by a German immigrant to the USA named Christian Frederick Martin. You may recognize that name from C.F. Martin of Martin & Co. we still use today. He came from a line of guitar builders in his family and did an apprenticeship in Vienna in the early 1800s. The first guitars built by Martin were very much inspired by the Venetian style of guitar building. These guitars had a distinct scroll-shaped headstock, metal machine tuners, and a pin bridge, all based on the designs of a Venetian luthier. Martin started his company in New York in 1833 and then moved to the Nazareth plant in Pennsylvania in 1839, where Martin still operates to this day. And in the early 1900s, he is said to have created a brand new type of guitar by designing an inner structure to stand the tension of steel strings. C.F. Martin was said to be the first person to design X-style bracing, although they never did apply for the patent on that, so it is up for debate amongst guitar historians. But it's definitely non-disputable that they were the first company to produce these guitars on a big scale. At the time, fan bracing was widely popular in Europe, and X bracing is an innovation that is still used to this day in acoustic guitar building. It allowed for a lot more stability in the structure of the guitar, as well as opening up the resonance and the sound. This bracing was first created in the mid-1800s and led the way for the switch to steel strings that came in the early 1900s. Before the acoustic guitar was properly formed, they were built more like a classical guitar. Looking back, it was quite common for classical guitars being used to be strung up with catgut strings. These were used on virtually all acoustic instruments at one point, including acoustic guitar, violin, lutes, cellos, double basses, and more. But I have to say, if you have ever looked into how these strings are made, as the name alludes, it does make me a little squeamish. So what a relief string makers and luthiers found some alternatives. As I mentioned in the intro, the need for steel-strung acoustics really came out of a necessity for acoustic guitars and instruments to be loud enough to carry over an ensemble. The redesign of the bracing and the build in these early C.F. Martin instruments and introduction of steel strings gave these guitars so much more volume than the previous catgut strung classical. C.F. Martin's signature dovetail neck joint was also hugely influential and helped to enhance the tonal transmission from the neck to the body. Martin & Co. pioneered many firsts in the acoustic guitar world, but one we will all be familiar with is the Dreadnought acoustic. This was initially designed in 1916 and they were exclusive made for a retailer called Oliver Ditson Company, but interestingly they did not sell well at all initially, so were dropped and later revised and revisited in 1931. This was after Martin and many other guitar manufacturers had struggled through the period of the Great Depression. A revision of the design and subsequent years following of popular use of the Dreadnought by many well-known folk musicians of the time meant this guitar quickly picked up in sales and is now one of the most prolific acoustic guitar shapes of all time. Martin definitely changed the future of acoustic guitar building forever. Thank you. So we've touched a little on C.F. Martin and his pivotal role in acoustic guitars. So let's take a quick look at some other moments in the early acoustic guitar timeline. Around 1880 and throughout this decade, Washburn came to prominence, building mostly parlor-style guitars initially, as well as banjos, mandolins and ukuleles, until they joined the archtop and then flat-top style of guitars, following companies like Martin. Another company which came to prominence in the latter part of the 1800s was Stella. This was founded by the Oscar Schmidt Company of the New Jersey area. This company thrived in the early 1900s and in 1920 was said to be one of the largest manufacturers of stringed instruments in the world. They were known for their good tone and their lower value compared to the Gibsons and the Martins of the time. They built mostly parlor-style guitars, which were created as a source of entertainment for people in their homes, often played in their parlor room, hence the name. These smaller body guitars were perfect for home playing, and due to their affordable price point, were widely popular with blues musicians. The Oscar Schmidt Company also had Scala and Sovereign brands, which were a slightly more premium option. Due to the build methods at the time though, these guitars would sometimes run into issues over the decades with wood rot and breakages due to the fragile bracing and bridge placements and the finish used at the time. But I thought it was worth a mention. Robert Johnson and Willie Nelson both played Stellas, and even Kurt Cobain on the recording of Polly. And you can see Leadbelly here playing his Stella 12 string. Unfortunately, much like the Washburn Company of the time, they struggled through the Great Depression and had to sell off. But if you ever come across a vintage Stella, Sovereign or La Scala, it would definitely be worth a play to hear that vintage sound in action. Mentioned a little bit about archtops previously, and that leads us nicely onto the next point of acoustic guitar history we have to talk about. Everyone watching must be familiar with Gibson, a brand known for their iconic Les Pauls and electric guitars, but back in the early days, Gibson was said to be the pioneers of the archtop style acoustic guitars and mandolins. Gibson was founded by Orville Gibson in 1894, working out of a one-man workshop in Michigan. He created the first archtop mandolin, which was then transferred to guitar. An archtop, as the name alludes to, has a violin-style archtop and back carved from a single piece of wood, thicker in the middle than the sides. The F-cuts, which came shortly after, are another key feature of the archtop-style guitars, modelled on the F-cuts you'd see on a violin. Whilst doing my research, I did find out that just a few years earlier, a lesser-known guitar maker of the time, A.H. Merrill, also patented a similar archtop-style design for mandolins and guitars. But as it's Gibsons that rose to popularity, particularly with jazz, blues and Western musicians at the time, it's the Gibson we think of today. The design of the archtop allowed for a loud sound, with the F-cuts perfect for any jazz big band gigs. The first non-archtop Gibson acoustic to be created was the iconic L1. This guitar was originally created as an archtop in 1902, but by 1926, Gibson had redesigned the guitar as a flat-top style acoustic. The L00 you can purchase from Gibson today is a nod to that original L1 flat-top guitar. It has a small parlor-esque body design and was widely popular for blues and folk musicians at the time, as it really gave that twangy but bright sound so well suited to these genres. Robert Johnson is noted to have also played one of these. In the early 2000s, Gibson even released a reissue of his guitar as a signature model and an ode to his original one. Upon the release of the Martin Dreadnought, Gibson then created their first big body acoustic with the Jumbo model. The J200, as it's now known, is now one of the most iconic Gibson acoustic body shapes. The first ones were made with a red spruce top and a rosewood back and sides. A combination you can imagine paired with the bigger body was a very loud and bassy guitar, making it good competition to the spruce top and rosewood or mahogany back and side dreadnoughts coming out of Martin. In 1947, the materials and designs changed to a super jumbo with maple back and sides, and this has remained the formula to this day. The maple paired with the spruce and the jumbo body make for a sweet, bright but full sounding acoustic. Many musicians in the 60s, including John Lennon, Bob Dylan, and Johnny Cash, were all famous for playing this style of guitar. In 1927 came the design of the resonator guitar by John Dopiera, an acoustic guitar with F cuts similar to the archtop style but fitted with a metal cone inside. You can imagine how it was becoming more and more essential for guitars to get louder to carry over their ever-growing ensemble units. The resonator style of guitar is one of the loudest acoustics, with the cone inside acting as a speaker to amplify the sound. By this point in the acoustic guitar evolution, you can see we are edging closer and closer to that need for amplified sound. By the 1930s, Lloyd Law, who worked for Gibson for a short time, created the first ever acoustic guitar pickup system. And this would have come around the same time as musicians began using microphones and was completely revolutionary. The first commercially available pickups, however, were made by Harry Diarmond, another brand you may be familiar with. And these were widely popular as they required no modification to the guitar itself. They slid under the sound hole using magnetic pickups made from a metal casing. There were two designed, one for a round hole acoustic and another for F-cut style guitars. In 1954, Gibson introduced the very first electro-acoustic model, the J160E, a sloped-shouldered Dreadnought similar to the now popular J45. By this time, electric guitars and amplifiers had come about, and the ability to amplify on stage was beginning to become the norm. This really paved way for a whole new experience for acoustic guitar players playing shows with a band. A moment in guitar history that changed the course of live and recorded music forever. The J160E was made famous by the Beatles, who used it in some of their televised performances in the 1960s. Before then, acoustic guitars would either have had to fit an external pickup or be played facing directly in front of a microphone. A method that somewhat restricts your movement on stage when performing by the musician having to ensure they stay directly in line with the microphone. In the decades that followed, many other acoustic guitar brands began manufacturing acoustic guitars with an electric pickup system inside, as the need for amplified instruments just grew and grew. By the 1980s, we had established brands such as Guild and Taylor Guitars all making prominence in the acoustic guitar world, many of them adopting the build, bracing, and methods of those early acoustic guitar pioneers like Martin. With X bracing remaining the go-to bracing method, and body sizes such as the Dreadnought, the Jumbo, Parlor, and the Triple O being used widely across the brands. Fast forward to today, and we are so lucky to have such an abundance of fantastic acoustic guitar luthiers, builders, and brands to choose from, each with their own individual practices and flavours. Every brand brings something different, be it Faith Guitars, started by Patrick James Eggle in the 1990s, using all solid tone woods across the whole range, or Taylor Guitars with their bespoke wood choices and unique V-style bracing, creating premium sounding guitars, to Ferndale with their wide range of different tone woods and body shapes, perfect for the up and coming player. And of course, Martin and Gibson still creating their iconic acoustic guitars, reminiscent of the very first acoustics that started this whole evolution. So that was a deep dive into the world and history of acoustic guitars. I hope you've enjoyed learning some of these interesting facts as much as I did discovering them. To find out any more information about any of the acoustic guitars I mentioned in this video, you can head to our website, pmtonline.co.uk. If you enjoyed this video, make sure to give it a like, drop us a comment, and hit that subscribe button. I've been Meg, and I will catch you in a video soon.